have tonight, this evening with us, Dahr Jamail, who many of you know as the one of the only unembedded journalists in Iraq. He spent 8 months there working actually with Salam, who was his interpreter. Dahr is the author of the amazing book, Beyond the Green Zone, Dispatches from an Unembedded Journalist in Iraq, and his reportings, which have won him several awards, the 2008 Martha Gellhorn Award for Journalism, a very prestigious award, the James Aronson Award for Social Justice Journalism, and the Joe A. Calloway Award for Civic Courage, as well as 4 Project Uncensored Awards. His book is actually on its second printing after its initial run of 10,000 copies. Yeah. And his dispatches can also be read at DahrJamailIraq.com. And he is now a frequent contributor to the Socialist Worker website as well, which is great. And Dahr's book, in my mind, is really, as he says, puts in his own words, is a tribute to the Iraqi people. And like I said, a voice that has been completely censored throughout this whole thing. And it really cuts through the disgusting lies and the racism that Iraqis are not fit to run their own society, that they lack certain capacities, as Condoleezza Rice once said. And Dahr's work could not be done without the help of courageous people like Salam Talib, who also put his own life at risk, helping to translate many of Dahr's important reports.
I'm going to try to cover a lot of ground really fast, but I can do that with this audience because we don't have to, you know, the assumed level of what is actually happening in this country and what's happening in Iraq and why. We have a high common denominator here as opposed to people who rely on corporate media. A lot of the time, I'm going to talk specifically about the situation on the ground in Iraq today, give you some broad brush strokes, and so you have an idea of how catastrophic it really is today. but I want to talk briefly about why I went, because there's a feeling now across this country, and especially in the anti-war movement today, of apathy, kind of this learned helplessness because of this administration basically giving us the finger on a regular basis and just going ahead and doing whatever they're going to do, whether it's invading Iraq or, you know, to hell with international law, whether it's let's go ahead and build some nuclear power plants, let's drill for some more oil, let's talk about bombing Iran now, let's give Israel more money and support. Whatever it is, they just, you know, it's hard to keep up spirits and keep fighting when it's just one huge defeat after another. But one thing that's guaranteed is if we don't take action, then certainly nothing's going to change. And I was up in Alaska when the war was launched, and I had been doing all these things. I was still kind of in the beginning stages of getting up to speed politically and understanding the fundamentals of what this country's all about. And I still thought that demonstrating and writing letters to senators and things were actually going to do something. And, you know, I guess, frankly, with the media and with this administration, I just got tired of eating the shit that they were shoveling out to all of us. I was insulted. And I took it personally when Bush brushed aside February 15, 03, the millions of people around the globe calling it a focus group. I just had taken enough, and I felt like, me personally, I've always loved to write. One thing I can do is go to Iraq and see what's happening and report on it myself. And so I figured out a way to get in there. It was very scrappy. It was kind of the Lonely Planet guide to going into a war zone, found a Lebanese guy in Baghdad. He told me how to get in, what hotel to stay at. But the thing is once I started going, and once I got to Amman, I started meeting exactly the right people at exactly the right time. I mean, I had very little money. I was basically just going in with a camera and a laptop and was going to send home emails about what was going on. And I kept meeting the right people at the right times, getting turned on to websites that I could post at. From there, getting picked up by various news organizations that I could write for. And so it went. And then I was able to go back for a second trip. And then I was able to go back for a third trip. And my point is, you know, here I am standing here in front of you almost 5 years later from when I first went in with a book, and my point is that you can make a difference if you find out what is happening, especially in our hearts, of what is the thing that I care the most about, what is the thing that I feel the most passionate about. Maybe it's not Iraq, maybe it's climate change, whatever, and go after that thing. But I want to go back to Iraq and just give you some broad brushstrokes of what I saw when I first went in there. My first trip was November 2003, and I just went in basically to bear witness. And one of the first things that I saw when I got into Baghdad, I was there less than 72 hours, and this is November 24, 2003. And stories of torture were everywhere. You couldn't walk down the street and get tea at a chai stand and talk to people without, within 5 minutes, hearing people talking about, yeah, my brother just got out of this military camp down in south or up north near Kirkuk or near Tikrit or Abu Ghraib. I mean, it wasn't just Abu Ghraib is my point. And people were talking about the use of German shepherds. And people were talking about sexual humiliation and degradation. People were talking about electricity. People were talking about being made to stand outside naked at night in late November when it's quite chilly and have cold water poured over them and having fans run on them. People were talking about loud music being played, not giving them any sleep. People were talking about desecration of the Quran. This is November 2003. The Abu Ghraib scandal broke in late April of 2004. And then there were other things that were just rampant, like home raids. Everywhere you go, I was hearing about home raids. Well, the U.S. military came into our neighborhood and came in and just took the men. They just took the men, and we don't know why. And you know, the story was almost exactly the same everywhere I went. They'd come late at night or in the middle of the night. They'd come barging in, smash through the front door. If they just would have knocked, we would have opened it. But they just come smashing through, and then they take people. And over time, then Abu Ghraib and other military detention facilities are just swelled with prisoners. And even the army itself has admitted that over 90% of the people being held in Abu Ghraib are innocent. And big surprise, when you look at the policy, and I've interviewed a lot of vets myself, big surprise when you go out and your goal is just to detain men between certain ages, 15 and 45, 12 and 70, whatever it is, then most of the people you detain are going to be innocent. It's common sense. But that was extremely common, and this is very, very early on in the occupation. Another thing that I think played a critical role was the fact that there was basically no attempt at real reconstruction. In the first year of the occupation under the CPA, $7 billion to this day went missing. And that was just the start. You know, we had Bechtel paid $2.3 billion. They withdrew in November 2006, and the majority of their projects were never finished. A huge percentage of them were never even started. I was reporting on this. I mean, Salam and I were going into Sadr City. I went south of Baghdad, and this is way back in January 2004, and interviewing the heads of water treatment plants who were telling me that, no, there's no Bechtel. We don't know. I mean, maybe some guys came through and threw some paint on something, but we've seen no instance of any kind of real reconstruction or help from the Americans or the Western contractors. And as a result, even back then, I was going into Sadr City and talking to people and having them either turn their tap all the way open and not a thing comes out, or turn their tap open and this kind of light brownish water comes out that smells kind of like a combination of a wet, dirty sock and with gasoline in it. And that was the water. And so fast forward from January 04 to June 2008, and big surprise, according to Oxfam International, they had a report that came out a little bit less than a year ago, 70% of the total population of the entire country of Iraq does not have access to clean drinking water. Now, if this was the case in the U.S., if we had, I don't know, if we had massive hurricanes and earthquakes all at the same time, and 70% of this country didn't have access to safe drinking water, how would that be reported? And contrast that with, did you even know that about Iraq? And you know, and if so, well, how is that being reported in the corporate media here? We talk about unemployment. Unemployment has ranged through the, about 6 months into the occupation, it's ranged from between 40 and 70%, according to the Iraqi government. Now, to give you an idea of how bad that is, we all have heard Great Depression stories in this country. Unemployment during the Great Depression here was about 26, 27%. In Iraq, at times, it's up to 70%. 45% of Iraqis are living on less than $1 per day in abject poverty. Most people in this room are familiar with how bad the sanctions were in Iraq. Lest we forget, this has been a bipartisan war of aggression against Iraq that has spanned decades. This is not just George Bush Jr.'s war against Iraq. This is a bipartisan war. We talk about the sanctions where over 500,000 Iraqi children died. We had the Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright's infamous admission on 60 Minutes to Leslie Stahl when asked, do you think that 500,000 dead Iraqi children is worth the price of containment of Saddam Hussein? And she said, well, it's a difficult decision, but yes, we think the price is worth it. My point is, it was really bad during the sanctions. The country was strangled, mostly men, mostly women, children, and elderly, and people with disabilities paying the price, the most vulnerable parts of the population. So we go from that. That's our baseline. When we talk about Iraq today, post-invasion Iraq, we're comparing it to the sanctions, right, where over a million people died, half of them kids. Compared to that, we've had a 9% increase in childhood malnutrition. I mean, compared to the sanctions, on all measurable levels, save for a very recent spike in oil production in Iraq, on all other measurable levels, everything is worse, whether it's water availability, employment, security, go on down the list. Electricity, the average home in Iraq has less than 5 hours of electricity per day. Their gasoline now is starting to get up to match ours as far as cost. Before the invasion, it was, what was it, about 20 cents a gallon, maybe?
7 cents.
7 cents a gallon, right. Other things that I've seen in Iraq, you know, to kind of piggyback on what Salam was saying as far as it's very clear when you're on the ground in Iraq that there was no design whatsoever to do anything to improve the lives of Iraqis or to help them. It's from the bigger military operations that I've covered, namely both in Fallujah, but then some others around Samar and Ramadi. What I saw from the early days of, of my time in Iraq was that there seems to be basically a standard operating procedure of, if you're having a lot of trouble in a town, insert name of city here, Bakuba, Ramadi, Fallujah, Samara, Haditha, Al-Qaim, go on down the list, then we're gonna collectively punish the entire area. We're gonna cut the electricity, we're gonna cut the water, we're gonna cut medical deliveries, we're gonna cut food deliveries, we're gonna start restricting who goes in and out of that city, Fallujah being the extreme example. And then once the operation starts, any moving vehicle, even if they're ambulances, is fair game. In Fallujah, I saw many ambulances with my own eyes shot or rocketed. I had friends in an ambulance that was shot up while they were in it, Western friends, U.S. and U.K. citizens, going out trying to help collect bodies to exploit their Western passports to get access. And obviously it didn't work. They were shot at. This type of thing, sending a very, very clear message. And I had a soldier tell me this specifically as we stood outside a secondary school that was being raided by the U.S. military, and they detained 16 school kids for having a pro-Saddam Hussein demonstration the day after he was captured. I asked, what's going on here? You know, why are you detaining school kids? And he said, well, anyone who stands in the way of our agenda here will be detained. I mean, that was it. And he knew I was a journalist. This translates into overall, as was said at the beginning 1.2 million Iraqis dead. That's according to Just Foreign Policy here and the ORB group over in London. Minimum 4.9 million refugees, half in the country, half outside of the country. 8 million Iraqis in need of emergency aid. I mentioned 70% not having access to safe drinking water. Talked about malnutrition, severe poverty. 8 million in need of emergency aid, meaning if they don't get access to that water, food, and medical attention when necessary, they're literally at risk for their lives. And when we add that up, that's about 14 million people out of a country with a total population of 26 million people. So that means over half, here we are well into the sixth year of the occupation, and that means that over half the total population of the country are either refugees in need of emergency aid or dead. And contrast that with how Iraq is being reported, if at all, in the corporate media today. So clearly, it still gets my blood boiling when we talk about the media, the so-called media, the so-called mainstream media in this country and what's happening in Iraq. But again, apply it to Afghanistan, apply it to what is our foreign policy, apply it to this farce of a presidential race in this country that followed this farce of who's going to get the Democratic nod, this horse race, these false choices that we're always presented with, as though when we talk about foreign policy, there's some huge difference between John McCain and Barack Obama. But if you listen to the media, you're never going to know this because they're not going to tell you. And the thought that I want to close with before we go into a Q&A is, as I said before about my own story, I didn't have any illusions that I was going to go to Iraq and ever write a book or report for any of the big outlets I've gotten to report to. But I can stand here and say that I have. I've gotten to write. It's been like a dream for me. I've gotten to write for Le Monde Diplomatique. I've gotten to write for the Sunday Herald in Scotland, the Independent, the Guardian, a lot of big places that I respect a lot, and a book, and have some articles that contribute to forcing the Pentagon to admit that they used white phosphorus in Fallujah. So I've been able to raise a little bit of hell. And my point is that if you think that not getting active and taking risks and putting some stuff on the line to try to affect positive change can't make a difference, I can stand here and personally tell you that you're wrong. But it's going to require risk and a lot of commitment and finding out exactly what it is that you're really passionate about and want to get involved in. It's really clear that they, the ubiquitous they being this administration and many before it, declared war on us a long time ago. They don't give a shit about us anymore than they give a shit about the Iraqi people. And we need to be really clear about what we're dealing with and what they're capable of and what they're willing to do. And I think that it's also very clear that we're being absolutely trounced. And I think that it's clear that at this point, what do we have to lose? We have climate change. We have ongoing occupation of Iraq, ongoing occupation of Afghanistan, very, very real possibility of bombing of Iran, which could potentially lead to nuclear weapons being used. All of this stuff happening or about to happen right now, I don't see how much more critical it could possibly be. And these people showing us on a daily basis, they're willing to keep all options on the table, go to any lengths. And so the thought I want to leave is not my own, but one that I think is really important for us to keep in mind, that we're well past the point of really having a luxury of taking a lot of time if anyone's still on the fence and not quite getting involved yet, to try to work for some positive change. And I think that we all have to recommit to whatever it is, if we're already involved in something, or if we already know what it is but haven't started taking some serious action towards it, to start doing that now. That we have to fight this, what's happening. We are on the front lines in this country. We're all privileged with being in the position just by being born in this country to be able to fight directly against this machine. It's of my opinion that we're also long past the point of doing so by any means necessary. Thank you.